Welcome to worship, everybody. It's so good to see you all. I am dressed casually today because we're having a Hawaiian luau after worship. No, I don't think there's anything Hawaiian downstairs, but we are having a lunch, so everyone please plan to stay. Although I've been told, you know, there is a looming Steelers kickoff, so we have to be done with church before that. But then I realized kickoff's not till 1, so I can preach extra long today. Right? So welcome to worship. So glad you're here. Do I have everything? Yes, I do. Let us begin our worship this morning with our call to worship, which this week is adapted from Psalm 94. The Lord knows all human plans.
He knows that they are wrong.
Blessed are those the Lord disciplines.
He grants them relief from days of trouble.
All right, let us pray. God our Father, to you we bring our confession. We have turned from the way of Jesus. We have quenched the Spirit's power. We have not shared the good news in word or deed. Our pride blinds and our anger burns, and we have failed to live your new life. Forgive our sin, O God, and free us from our disobedience. Strengthen us in your grace and love, that we may serve you as faithful disciples and live in your joy. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Our announcements for today, September Mission, Kern City Backpack Program. This week and next week, so last day, we're collecting money for that. So mark your envelope, but you can bring in your food items as well. With the reminder that next week, Kayla Smith, who is the president of the organization that operates the backpack program in Kern City, she will be here with you all to share about their organization, Kern City Communities That Care, about the backpack program and some other things. So I hope you're looking forward to that. She will be here in place of me because I will be on vacation starting next Saturday. So I'll be here throughout the week. So if you need anything, give me a call. But Jim and Judy have graciously volunteered or said, I guess I'll do it. They're going to lead our service next week with Kayla Smith coming in and bringing you a presentation. So I hope you look forward to that. I think it'll be great for you to hear about everything they're doing. Of course, because if you've been smelling, we've been talking about, there's potluck lunch after service today, right? There's so much food down there, folks. So come, have a good time. Bible study this Thursday at 10 at Allegheny Hills. That's for everybody. You don't have to live at that building. But in addition to that, we're going to be finishing, I think this time, we're actually going to finish the letter of James in the New Testament, which we thought we were going to finish last time, but some guy kept talking. I don't know who it was. But in addition to that, we're also going to be having communion at that time. So come to that. If you know people who live in high-rise who might want to participate in communion with us, let them know about that. Any other announcements from the congregation? I suppose it is that time of year. I'll give you a heads up. The end of October is coming, so anytime you want to start bringing in full-size candy bars for our trick-or-treat extravaganza that we do here, that would be great and greatly appreciated. All right, let us pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for today. We thank you for the changing of the seasons, God, as we look at the weather forecast. We think, oh, one more day of heat and humidity, but then maybe the weather's changing and we'll get some relief and some cooler air, God. And so we thank you just because it reminds us of how you're always changing things in this world in order to make it work, God, in ways we don't even understand. It just breaks our minds to think about everything that you work together all at once. And you know, so many people become experts in this, experts in that, but you're expert in it all the time and you just make it work, God. And so we thank you, we lift you up for just being that great God who does that, makes us a world where we can live in, Father. Thank you so much. We thank you for all the different things you do in our lives from day to day, week to week, month to month, to show that you care about us, you love us. Things often we just overlook, we just take them for granted, God, but they're gifts, blessings that you've given us. As Chris has reminded us, we thank you that when we pray, God, you hear us, and it's always encouraging when we see something or someone we've prayed for and see how you've worked in their lives. And so we thank you because we know as we bring these prayers to you, God, as there are requests and petitions within this prayer, we know you hear it. We know you will answer it in a way that brings about your glory the best. And we know that you will answer it in a way that deeply cares for us. And so we say thank you. Most of all, we say thank you for giving us your Son, Jesus Christ, through whose work on the cross we now have peace with you. We can come to you, God. We can be in community and relationship with you. We have forgiveness of sins, the promise of eternal life with you and your glory and goodness. Thank you, God. Let us never forget. As the world assails us, as things come up in life and we get into times, situations where we don't want to go on, we don't know how we're going to go on, remind us, God, how much you love us and what you have done for us. And let that give us hope as we tarry with you in this place. God, let it be what reinvigorates us to go out into your world, to love other people. God, help us to love ourselves as you love us, as you see us, so we can go love other people. Open our eyes to the opportunities you give us to love them. God, help us not to be timid or embarrassed or ashamed or afraid, but let us go love and love people so that they can see your love in action. And as we're doing it, God, again, make us bold. And we don't just love people with actions, but we tell them the gospel of Jesus Christ. For what good does it do if they gain the world, but they forfeit their souls? So God, let us be bold proclaimers of your gospel so that people might hear, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, they would repent and believe unto eternal life. God, let that be the work of your church, to always lift you high, to always glorify you, and always be those people who are proclaiming your goodness and your gospel to this world. God, we pray for East Brady Baptist Church, that you continue to knit us together in love, that you continue to support us and guide us and provide for us. And God, again, just to open our eyes to see how you've equipped us to minister to this community, God. We pray for your churches and our community and surrounding community and in this nation, all over the world, God, that you would continue to grow them in faith. Help us to glorify you more and more and to seek you more and more, God. And God, we really pray for repentance within your church, where so often we've chased after other things, other voices, other ideologies, and we've just accepted them and we've kind of molded your word around other things rather than doing the exact opposite. God, forgive us and bring us back to your word. Let everything we do, everything we're about, everything we say, everything we pursue be found in that. When we look to your word, God, help us to understand it. Help us to see how it applies to our life today and what you're saying in it eternally, even to us as we live in the year 2024. God, we pray for your brothers and sisters and our brothers and sisters in Christ who worship you and serve you in places where it's dangerous for them, that you would help them, protect them, give them perseverance through their trials, God, and just help them overcome completely. We pray for their persecutors, that they would see the faith of those they are persecuting, and that by your Holy Spirit they would be convicted, and they too would turn to you for eternal life. God, we pray that through your church then, you would bring revival to this world, that you would bring salvation to those who don't yet know it, don't yet have it, and that it would be just something that just sweeps over this globe, God. How phenomenal that would be. But let your church be faithful to you in doing that. God, we pray for the United States, our country. We thank you for giving us this country of freedom. We can come together and worship freely. But God, there are so many who have turned against you, turned against what you say is right or holy. So many who just want to argue and fight and battle back and forth. And so many people, even within your churches, who aren't those peacemakers you call us to be. We don't seek you, God. Forgive us and help us to change so that, again, we can lead where your Holy Spirit leads in revival. We pray for the nation as we select a new leader coming in November, that you give us wisdom, that you work through things in this world, God, to bring the person you desire into that position. God, we pray that you use all our leaders, from the most local and the most perhaps simple organizations right on up to the President of our United States, God. Work through them to bring about your good purposes on this earth. When they are turned away from you, bring them to you. When they are turned away from you, use them anyway, God, to bring about what you desire. God, we pray it all in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. speeding right through the book of Acts, we now come to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, we're going to start today at verse 22.
Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said,
"People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead."
When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said,
"We want to hear you again on this subject."
At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others.
Well, back in my Boy Scouting days, a long time ago, I remember we were doing an activity when we were learning how to read a compass. So it's called orienteering. And we were learning how to do that. Well, one of us held the compass, and they put a big brown shopping bag over our head. So we couldn't see anything other than, you know, there was a gap between the bag and our bodies. We could look down, and we could see the compass. And then there was a second scout standing next to us who had a list of step-by-step instructions to give us that would require us to use the compass to move a certain number of steps in one direction, and then the next one was like move a certain number of steps in the different direction. We had to use the compass to know which direction to go, all in order to get to the end. We were supposed to reach, blindfolded pretty much, a particular spot marked as our goal. And then they said you can get there just by following the compass accurately. Well, I put that bag over my head, and I did step by step exactly what those instructions said. And sure enough, when I got to the end and I removed that bag, I was nowhere near the goal. The goal site was like way over on the other side of this big parking lot we were in. It turns out that when I couldn't see where I was going, my steps were a lot smaller than they usually are. So I had accurately followed the directions. I just hadn't moved as far as I could with each step in any direction that I went. The point is, when I was groping around trying to find something pretty much in the dark, I was able to get some things right to get me where I was going. But others I got completely wrong. And so even though I tried real hard, I just couldn't get where I needed to be. That was the condition of the people in Athens in the first century when Paul first visited their city. They had been trying, working really hard to figure out this God stuff, figure out how to get to God and how to honor him and how to worship him. But it was like they were groping around in the dark trying to find him. They could only ever get part of it right. And so for that reason, they just pursued whatever ideas of gods anyone had. They would just say, I'll take that and I'll take that and I'll take that and take that. And they were about it all. This is a fact that the Apostle Paul pointed out to them that when he was invited to speak in one of their public forums. You see, after spending a little bit of time looking around their city, Paul tells them, "People of Athens," and it's translated with an exclamation mark. So you know the original language is emphatic. "The people of Athens, I see that in every way you are religious." Because everywhere Paul would have gone in Athens, everywhere he would have looked, he would have encountered another altar, another shrine, another temple, another idol depicting yet another god. Athens was indeed littered with idols in the first century. In the second century, Greek geographer Pausanias wrote, "The Athenians greatly surpassed others in their zeal for religion." And he indicated that there were more idols in Athens than the rest of Greece combined. I don't know if he did a count or whatever, but that's what he said. Gaius Petronius, who was a Roman satirist in the first century, he concurred, and he wrote, "It was easier to find a god in Athens than a man." So sorry to all the single ladies looking for a man in Athens, right? Pliny, who was a little bit more familiar to us, is a Roman author and philosopher in the first century. He tells us that in the time of Caesar Nero, which is a little bit after the time we're looking in today, Athens had over 30,000 public statues, besides all the ones in the private homes. Every porch also had its own protecting god. They lined the streets, and they caught the eye of every place of prominence. They were everywhere. And Paul recognized that. In doing that, the Athenians, they were trying really hard to get this god stuff right. But it was kind of like they were groping around in the dark looking for God, right? You ever notice when you're kind of reaching around in the dark trying to find something? Everything you touch has a possibility of being what you're looking for until you kind of feel it a little bit more and you're like, oh, that's not it. But up until that, whatever it is you touch, it might be what you're looking for. And that's how the Athenians were. Every idea or notion about God they came across had the possibility of being what they were looking for. And so they just embraced it all, they celebrated it all, they worshiped it all. But even then, they knew, they seemed to understand, they probably weren't seeing the whole picture, which is why it was a common thing to find in Athens, altars and shrines dedicated to unknown gods. Here's what's left of one that archaeologists have uncovered. That was an altar to an unknown god. And it's like they were just praying the air, whatever, whoever might be out there. Hey, if you're out there and we're overlooking you, hey, we're so sorry. We love you too. Here's an altar for you too. Paul pretty much tells them, I've seen one of these altars to an unknown god. And that's how I know you're really serious about this religion stuff. It's like Paul saying, you're admitting you don't understand the very thing you're worshiping. That's what he tells them. But now, Paul says, I'm going to tell you about it so you do understand. So what was not known before is known, can be known. And then Paul proceeds to tell them all about this so-called unknown god, which Paul knows very well. He is the one Paul knows is the God of all gods, the God over everything. And we're going to look specifically at what Paul recognizes that they, and I would say all people who are serious about God, need to know. There are quite a few of them in this passage, what Paul talks about God. So they're all really important. We have to look at them all, so we're going to have to go through them kind of quickly. But before we even do that, I first want to point out a couple of things regarding how Paul goes about sharing this message with the people in Athens in this context, right? And the first thing I notice is that Paul doesn't start by ranting and raving about how awful these Athenians are for going after all these other so-called gods. We read in verse 16 that Paul was greatly distressed by all the idol worship. It seems it made him sick to his stomach. But he doesn't blast them for it. Instead, Paul quotes some of their own pagan theologians about some of the attributes of God. He does it twice in verse 28. He quotes, see if I can get these names right, the Cretan philosopher Epimenides, yeah, and the Sicilian Stoic philosopher Aratus. That's a little bit easier. He quotes them both. These are truths about the true God that these pagan theologians had figured out And these pagan theologians would have been known to the Athenians. So they already got part of it right. But rather than being afraid and dancing around that fact, it's like Paul's not saying, oh, if I mention them, they're just going to think everything they say is true and I shouldn't really say anything at all. No, Paul instead uses these things as a means of finding common ground and building rapport with the people. He uses these things as an entry point into a larger discussion about who God is. And I think the point of application for us in that today is pretty simple to understand. You see, there are times, a lot of times, when we too are greatly distressed by actions and beliefs of those around us, actions and beliefs that do not reflect the truth of who God really is. And we're greatly distressed by that. But rather than just lambasting people around us for it, maybe there are times we just need to swallow that, like Paul did. So instead, we can look for things they already have in their own lives that we can use to build common ground. We can build a rapport to enter into a deeper relationship or conversation with them about who God really is. So if you're just going out there accusing everybody of everything that they're doing and just yelling at them for everything, they're not going to listen to a thing you say. Second, Paul, in this context right here, does not present the full gospel message. Isn't that interesting? He doesn't talk about the gospel here. In fact, neither the full gospel message nor Jesus himself are mentioned by Paul here, although they're both strongly hinted at toward the end of his talk. Paul seems to recognize that these people are not going to care about how much they've sinned against this God. They're not going to care about how much Jesus has done for them to free them from the wrath brought on by their sin against this God until they first understand who this God is and why they should care about him. So follow Paul, his first focus is on that. Get them to know who God is, with the understanding that eventually he will present the gospel on top of it to those who want to hear more. Again, I think the practical application of this is simple for us. Often we just, what do we want? We just want to be out there banging people over the head with the Jesus stuff, right? And don't get me wrong, I love the Jesus stuff. The Jesus stuff is necessary. It's eternity-changing stuff. It's great stuff. But a lot of people just aren't ready to hear it. We need to recognize that a lot of people have not been told the basics of who God is, or for whatever reason, they haven't heard before, they haven't fully grasped it, they haven't understood. So before telling them how much they have sinned against this God and how they can be saved before this God, we need to help them understand first who this God is and why they should care. It's the same thing Paul did in Athens. And it's the same thing he does in the things we're going to cover today. So here we go. Who is God according to the Apostle Paul? Well, first he starts out in verse 24 saying, "The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands." Paul's saying, hey, the God I'm telling you about isn't some local God or just some being out there that kind of has some powers, is maybe strong and can maybe control some things around them and maybe even some things in your life. No, he is the God, and as such, he is the Lord over heaven and earth because he created the whole world and everything in it. And he's the creator. And as such, he's too big, he's too glorious, he's too awesome to ever live in any of these temples or shrines or statues that we people can just build with our hands. I mean, take a look at this. Here's what's left of just three of the temples that would have been in Athens in Paul's day. I mean, imagine how magnificent they and so many others must have been in Paul's time when they were relatively new. All these homes made by human hands for their gods. But the God Paul speaks of is beyond every single one of them. Pretty impressive. Rather, this God is the master of everything, including the very materials the people use to construct these things. He's the Lord over all of it, Paul says. He goes on verse 25 to say, and he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. See, this God Paul's telling them about did not need anything from the people. You know, that's in opposition to what some of the beliefs were regarding the so-called Greek gods who were sustained by the people on earth, serving them and loving them, and, you know, their egos were sustained by that, so they existed. No, the God of the universe is not sustained at all by human service. but rather, Paul points out, he gives life and breath to us. God is the source of life, and as such, he is the author and sustainer of human life. And God gives it to us freely. Every breath you take, a gift from God. Every instance of life you see around yourself, even when you're looking in the mirror, a gift from God. Although God might include us in carrying out his plans because he loves us and desires to give us a purpose, so he gives us things to do to serve him, he doesn't need any of us in any way. But we certainly need him in every way, even to just merely exist. This is what Paul's trying to express to the Athenians. Well, he gets a little more grounded here in verse 26 when he says, from one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. Forget this idea that humans, kings, emperors, armies decide who rules and takes control of lands by their own strength, by their own force, by their own military might, whatever. No, God does that all. God decides that all. And he makes it happen. He sets the timetable for when nations and governments are actually going to exist and when they're going to be prominent in history. It's all God's plan, Paul says, as he shapes it all, bringing all the nations of earth into existence from just one man. God did that. And even today, we need to be reminded of this truth about God. Humans are not in control of what happens on this earth, regardless of how much worldly power they might wield. If you think God is in heaven, worried about who's going to win the upcoming presidential election and what's going to happen on the earth if the wrong person gets elected, think again. He's already marked it off, as he does all things. He has appointed what will come to pass at this time in history. Well, whether we understand why he does it that way or not, he has done it. So if you trust God and he's not worried, the question is, why are you? Well, Paul goes on to tell the Athenians, God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. Paul tells them, and by extension, he reminds us, that everything God is doing or has done in this world has a purpose, and the purpose is this: so that we humans would recognize that he is out there and we would seek after him. All of history has that purpose. This is different from what the Athenians would have understood from the motivations of their so-called gods, because their so-called gods were narcissistic and sadistic and selfish. Their gods would supposedly intervene on earth from time to time merely to get an ego trip from the human's response, or out of boredom. They would just move things in place just to watch how the humans scurry, and like the humans are just little playthings. But the God of the universe that Paul speaks of is intimately involved in everything that happens on this earth for this purpose, to bring people into relationship with him. He does this for us to find him. He doesn't keep himself hidden away up on some mountain or anywhere else so he can laugh at our efforts to find him or laugh at our efforts to get by on our own. He's actually very close by to everyone, Paul says. And he desires that we seek him out and find him. And he sets the world in motion. He sets everything happening in the world in motion to assist us in that. Everything that happens in his creation is designed to help us find him. So in verse 29, Paul says, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. See, Paul's letting everyone know that, hey, you really want to seek God, you really want to know this God and find him, then you have to stop thinking about him and defining him in human terms. See, the people of Athens, they were defining their idea of God by whatever image they could create out of stone or maybe more fine, costly things like silver or gold. They were the good gods, right? And they would get this idea in their head of what God must be, and they try to make that with their hands. Whatever their own hands came up with and crafted, that was God, and they would worship it then, even though they just made it there by themselves, as if they had captured the essence of this God in this carved image. And I got to tell you, we do the same thing today, though not with gold, silver, or stone. We still corrupt the idea of God by recreating him in our own image, complete with human failings and limitations. We limit who God is according to what our own minds can imagine or understand. An image, you might say, of human design and skill. And that's why you hear people saying things like that. Well, I can't follow a God who would allow... dot, dot, dot. You fill in the blank. You've all heard people say things like this. What do they say? I can't follow a God who would allow children to continue to starve in Africa. Because we always come back to that. They say that because the image of God they have created in their own minds is one who would solve that particular problem right now the way they think it should be solved. What they don't understand is that God is solving that problem, just not their way. He's not failing. He's not coming up short in accomplishing the good of ridding the world of salvation. He's actually in the process of doing it, and when he brings it to fruition, they will see that his solution far exceeds anything they could have imagined about how it would come about. He's just doing it in a way that's too big, too awesome for them to see and comprehend. So what people are trying to do is they're actually limiting God according to their own limitations, their own understanding, according to their own idea. Paul tells the Athenians and us by extension that if we really want to seek God and find God, we must accept that he is way beyond anything we can come up with on our own. We must worship him for who he is, not for who we have thought up in our own minds. Oh, well, my God's this and this. He loves me. He doesn't care that I do this because my God wouldn't care about that. No, we must worship him for who he is. We let go of what we've thought up in our own minds, and then maybe we just might find him. In verse 30 and 31, Paul tells the people that God now commands. He uses the word command. He says, God commands that all people everywhere need to repent, not just those weird Jews in Jerusalem. Everyone everywhere needs to repent, turn from their way of life, and turn to God and live his way. See, we're starting to get into the gospel here, aren't we? And he warns them why. He says, because God will judge. He will judge the whole world. He created it all, so he reserves that right. And he will do it justly. When he judges, he will bring justice, as he did through the man he has appointed. Again, here Paul is finally beginning to hint at Jesus. He's hinting he's going to get into more here. And he concludes by saying that God has proved himself able, willing, and worthy to do this by raising this man from the dead. Again, we know he's talking about Jesus, although the Athenians didn't at that point. See, Paul's ready now to get into the gospel. The people are now ready to hear about Jesus and his good news. Paul can serve the meal now because the table has been set. You know, many of you know at my house and at Thanksgiving, we try to have a large group of people. And, you know, I grew up in a family. We had close to 70 people at Thanksgiving dinner. And then the other side of the family, there were always like 30 or 40 people. So it was like always a lot of people, right? We get up to about 25, and that's enough for us. You know, that's good. But we usually end up serving dinner around 2 p.m. in the afternoon because that's the time it is when we get everything ready. But when I get up that day, while my sister is working in the kitchen to prepare the feast, my efforts are solely in the dining room to set the tables. All right, you got to set up all the tables. You got to track down enough chairs. Mom and Dad get tired of seeing me Thanksgiving morning because I'm over there borrowing something else again. I need a table. I need chairs. I need an end table. You know, just whatever. Right? You got to set it up so that everyone can get around in the dining room, get to their seats and be comfortable. Then you get all the tablecloths on and all the plates and bowls and silverware and glasses and napkins and anything else that needs to go there. You got to get it all in the right place. Then you got to get those centerpieces on there. And then we start bringing the food out and setting it there, and everything has to have a place, and there's never enough room for even all the food on the table, right? But we got to get it set. And I do that because, number one, I know, number one, nobody else is going to do it. But number two, as hard as my sister is working to make that feast, we will not be able to eat it until the table is set. And that's what Paul has been doing. He has set the table now for feeding the people the good news of Jesus by declaring to the Athenians who this supposedly unknown God is. He has done that. Really, you get what Paul is expressing here? He is expressing the holiness of God. Not everything about the holiness of God, but quite a bit of it. That's everything Paul says is just God is holy. He's holy. He is completely separate from all else in that he is the almighty creator of the whole world and everything in it. And he has worked all things throughout all of history in this world. And in his all-knowingness, his all-powerfulness, and his presence everywhere in all times, he is a God so far beyond anything mere humans can come up with and fully understand. He is holy. And in his holiness, he desires for all people to seek him and be in relationship with him in his holiness forever. That's Paul's message to the Athenians and to all of us today, that he is a holy God who desires to be known by all people. He's not an unknown God. He desires to be known, and we know that this is ultimately accomplished by repenting and believing in Jesus. See, Paul, he finally gets to the point now. He's going to share specifics about the gospel and how to be saved by faith in Jesus. And some, Luke writes, are eager to hear more. They invite him back. Oh, we want to hear the rest of this. Did you catch what some of the others did? Particularly when Paul starts talking about resurrection, they sneer. That's a lovely word, sneer. What they're doing is they're rejecting the message. And I think that's kind of a final takeaway for us today. Some will embrace the truth of God's holiness. They'll recognize, hey, God is out there, someone I should acknowledge and form my life around. And some will reject it. And we must accept that. We can't make people believe it or follow it. We can't force them to embrace the message. All we can do is first living according to the message as Paul did. Because maybe I've been talking here today about some of the holiness of God, some of these things, and maybe you haven't been acknowledging them. Maybe you haven't lived according to that. Maybe you've kind of allowed your mind to start be polluted by the ideals of the world and have thought, oh, that's not really who God is. No, this is who God is. First, we live according to the message ourselves as Paul did. And second, we declare the message as Paul did. Let us pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for today. We thank you for everything that you've given us. And we thank you that you've given us the message of the gospel. But God, we thank you that you're not a God who stands far off, who can't be known, who doesn't want to be approached. But we thank you that you're the exact opposite. You desire to be in relationship with us. You give us your Son, Jesus Christ, so we can approach you, so we can know you, not just in this moment, but in every moment for all eternity. God, thank you so much for giving us that gift. And may we ever lift you high for your holiness. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.